Memory. How do you define it? How are we even able to store experiences that happen outside of our body, somewhere inside our heads? And how is it possible that we can recall and relive those experiences again? These questions have intrigued thinkers and scientists throughout the ages, because this innate ability of remembering is what lets us define our existence. How else would you be able to describe your favorite food, the name of your pet, or the first time you rode a two-wheeler? A memory is made up of all the information taken in by our senses, the sights and sounds, what we can touch and feel, and all sorts of other information is sent to the brain, where large-scale connections between different brain structures work together to make sense of all the bits and pieces of information. One such important structure is called the hippocampus. Located deep within the brain, the hippocampus plays a crucial role in storing long-term memories in a process called consolidation. The hippocampus receives information from many other areas of the brain, and its job is to integrate and organize that information by strengthening connections known as synapses between cells. It does this by using proteins, which are complex molecules that serve a variety of functions. Some proteins hold things together. Some make changes on existing structures, and some make other kinds of new proteins. It's really the proteins that are the star of learning and memory. Our relationship with the world around us is ultimately translated into the minuscule yet extremely significant changes in their function. And so, the proteins in the hippocampus continue putting together the information about an experience that is being conveyed to it by other brain regions. It then stores or consolidates that memory so that it can be brought back up later. But the hippocampus is not the only structure responsible for memory storage. When an experience doesn't make you feel all too great, if it's sad or scary or embarrassing, another structure called the amygdala takes over. The amygdala uses proteins just like the hippocampus to do its work, but it's the place where brain regions direct their complaints to. And by organizing and integrating them, the amygdala is able to attach a negative emotional valence to a memory, which turns out to be a super important learning adaptation. That's how we know to keep away from being in a similar situation in the future. Although the amygdala is just about the size of an almond, and the hippocampus is not much larger, both structures have an irreplaceable role in our ability to learn and remember. Without them, we'd never get around to correcting any of our mistakes, or, more importantly, we'd never learn. Now, even though we depend on our memory to make predictions for the future, it isn't the only determiner of decision-making. In life, there is always so much going on, so many pros and cons for the brain to weigh between, and a lesson from the past is just one of them. Just think, if you only depended on your past, you'd never take a second shot at anything after failing it the first time. You wouldn't be able to tie your shoes, get over that first day of school trauma, do a math calculation, or ride a bike, because the ability to forget or change a memory is just as important as it is to form one. So not only is the brain an immensely complex network of neurons buzzing with information that is communicated between a trillion synapses, it's able to integrate and store that information physically by using proteins, and in a way that allows room for change later on. And just when you thought you understood human behavior, you learn instead that things are not that simple at all. But you know what? It's okay, because when it comes to the brain, complexity is how we roll.